Thanks a lot, Jeremy. We'll move straight into an hour if anyone's any more time. So our first speaker today is going to be Roz Ward. Roz moved to the country almost a decade ago, and ever since then she's been a pretty hardcore activist for LGBTI rights and around a host of other issues, but most notoriously in recent times as the co-founder of the excellent Safe Schools anti-bullying program for LGBTI youth. So please make Roz welcome.
I also want to welcome anybody here who's from the Australian newspaper or anybody who's writing anything up for them or recording this meeting. Good luck getting me to make a comment on record to you ever. Anyone from any other media who's written nice things about Safe Schools Coalition, you're actually very welcome. So, looking at the reality of homophobia and transphobia today, I mean, I work at La Trobe University and I have since 2008, formerly as a researcher, as an academic who specialises in social research about homophobia, transphobia, the experiences of LGBTI people and the impact on our health of those forms of discrimination. And the reality from that research is actually that in the last 15 years in Australia, the level of homophobia experienced by young people and older people remains virtually unchanged in those 15 years. And we still know that young people experience very high levels of physical and verbal homophobic abuse. Nearly one in five same-sex attracted young people has been physically abused because of their sexuality on the basis of homophobia. 61% have experienced verbal abuse, and the majority of that happens while they're at school, which is why Safe Schools Coalition exists. It's not a very complicated equation. For transgender and gender diverse young people, of which more and more are coming out talking about their gender identity, the situation is even worse in terms of transphobia and the impact of transphobia on people's lives. The amount of support and services available to transgender people in Australia is very mixed, very poor, very expensive, very difficult to access. The gender unit at the Royal Children's Hospital, close to the Safe Schools Coalition, has a massive waiting list, and if you're basically 15, 16 or 17, you're not going to get seen by that clinic. You will have to wait till you're 18 to get support from the Monash Hospital. And if you're younger, the waiting list, although it's been reduced recently, is still often up to a year to get your first support. And the outcomes, as we know, are really poor around higher rates of depression, suicide, self-harm, and so on. And, yeah, in the face of all of this, young people still continue to, in all the schools that we work with, really defy all the messages that they're fed and say, no, this is who I am, and this is who I'm going to be, and I'm going to be that person. My sexuality and my gender identity are valid, and I'm going to express those in my school, even in the face of homophobia and transphobia. And the amount of young people who, you know, are questioning ideas and stereotypes and the binary nature of gender continues to increase, even in the face of all of the barriers that are set up to stop them from doing that. And schools are these places where, you know, from the moment you walk through the door, everything is gendered. And, you know, which toilet you go to, which uniform you wear, when people say, girls at the back, stop talking, boys, lift the heavy table for me, etc., etc. Gender exists all throughout schools. And so you can see why they become these hotbeds of homophobia and transphobia. And actually, for intersex people, and we also work to support intersex people, people with intersex variations at Safe Schools Coalition, the kind of treatment that they are subject to, or mistreatment really, is some of the most horrific you can really think of for anybody in Australia today. Although there's a obviously a massive list of people who are horrifically treated by the Australian state. So there was an article, it was last year actually now in Nature, that talked about the treatment of intersex people. And it's not just a social theory, it's not a crazy Marxist gender theory or whatever, it's science that shows that there are more than two biological sexes, and that biological sex really is just as much of a construct as gender is. And biologists wrote about this and said that biologists may have been building a more nuanced view of sex, but society is yet to catch up. When it comes to sex, there is still intense social pressure to conform to a binary model. This pressure has meant that people born with clear DSDs, which are technically disorders of sex development, often undergo surgery to normalize their genitals. Such surgery is controversial because it's usually performed on babies who are too young to consent and risks assigning sex at odds with the child's ultimate gender identity. And it's called corrective surgery, right? So one of the rationales for performing this corrective surgery that was given in 2013, so this is not something that was written decades ago, this is very recent rationale, that says we need to correct these people's bodies, is to allow them the future prospect of getting married. That's the rationale, because there's a psychosocial distress associated with not having a body that's normative enough for a heterosexual relationship with somebody of the opposite sex that then allows you to marry that person. And so if we don't basically correct your body, you won't have that prospect and your life will be much more miserable. As if getting married is potentially any less miserable. But you can see then that the kind of heteronormativity that occurs in society, you know, reaches through every element of our lives, our bodies, our genders, our sexualities, our relationships, our families, and every single aspect. So I guess to think about what happened with me, to say something about that quickly, Sex Schools Coalition has been running since 2010. It didn't start as a controversial program. It's become controversial because opponents of the program have been actively campaigning against it. And I mentioned the Murdoch Press because, I mean, there are dozens and dozens, literally tens of thousands of words that have been written to try and condemn Safe Schools Coalition and me and the things that we're trying to achieve. And I'll just quote from one of my favourites, Miranda Devine, to give you a sense of it. I'm sure you're pretty aware of it. But she not only wants to say that it's just my sort of evil engineering, but to really attack all academics in social science who really have any other view of gender than the conservative one. She said, "You only have to look at the latest newsletter for La Trobe University's Australian Research Centre in Sex, Health and Society, where I work, to see the buoyant optimism of the sexual engineers. They are confident that their agenda to remake the family is proceeding according to a plan laid out more than a century ago by the architects of communism, Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels." Yeah. And that, you know, really sort of summed up all of the things that they've been writing. And it's not just, well, yeah, other people can say more about that. I probably shouldn't. So how can we do something about it? One of the arguments that's coming up at the moment, especially around the plebiscite, I think Louise will talk more about the marriage equality campaign, is that it really should just be LGBTI people who are involved in struggles for LGBTI liberation. And I think it's a really important argument to think about, and one that I actually totally disagree with. Because I don't think the struggle for LGBTI liberation can be won just by LGBTI people ourselves. And I think if we look at history and if we think about politics, our two most useful guides in these things, you can see so many different examples that prove this point. If you look back at the first gay liberation movements and groups in the US and the UK, and it was a bit later on here in Australia, these emerged in the 60s and 70s as part of a radicalisation that included all sorts of hundreds of thousands of people across society, mostly workers, mostly people who were working class, ordinary people, not people at the top of society. And these people were engaged in all sorts of struggles, industrial struggles, the struggle in opposition to the Vietnam War, emerging black rights movements, and so on. And the Gay Liberation Front in the 70s was an explicitly revolutionary movement. It was explicitly revolutionary and anti-capitalist. And one of the leaders in Australia, Dennis Altman, who probably wouldn't say this today, but he said it then, he wrote, "Gay liberation sees with Marx that the liberation of each depends on the liberation of all. For the homosexual cannot win liberation without a general sexual liberation." In Tribune, which was the newspaper of the Communist Party of Australia, Dennis Freeney, who was an openly gay leader of the Communist Party of Australia at that time in the early 70s, he published an article called Gay Liberation, which was actually before any gay liberation groups were formed. It was published in the newspaper of the Communist Party. In Australia, again, the context of the early gay liberation movement was the general strike in 1969, the massive anti-war movement, the student movement of the 60s, the women's liberation movement, and the emerging Aboriginal rights movement. So again, you can see how the struggles intersected and built each other at that point. And I think for me, that film that came out last year, or the year before now, Pride, about the gay and lesbian solidarity with the miners' strike in Britain, really illustrates that idea of solidarity, which sits at the heart of socialist politics. So the gay and lesbian activists of that time recognised that they shared the same interests as the miners in fighting back against the right-wing government of Margaret Thatcher. And at that time, they knew that the result of the miners' struggle against the anti-union Tory government was key to their struggle for LGBTI rights. And so when they worked together, they strengthened each other. And the same logic applies in the reverse. So the Section 28, which I remember from being at school in Britain in the 80s and 90s, when I was at school, there was a local government act passed in 1988 by the Thatcher government, which included this section, Section 28, which read, schools are basically banned from, and quote, "promoting or teaching the acceptability of homosexuality as a pretended family relationship." That was the exact wording of that law in 1988 in Britain that Thatcher passed to stop people talking about homosexuality in schools. So you can see there's a lot to learn from history about what's happening today as well. And in Australia, of course, when Howard passed the Marriage Act in 2004, it wasn't out of nowhere. It was in the same time and context of the work choices legislation directed against workers and organised workers in trade unions. But saying all of that, that we need solidarity, that we need to look to other people's struggles to support our own and vice versa, doesn't mean we have to wait for everything to suddenly be happening in society to be able to be effective today. And, you know, my personal experience in the last few months shows that when we're under attack, as we are, I think, at this point, the best response to that is to stand up and to fight back. And a lot of people have tried to silence me in the last few weeks and months and days and hours, and they've all failed. And it's not because I'm such a strong individual, and people ask me, how are you so strong? How are you coping with all this stuff, whatever? I am pretty strong, I'm pretty buff. I've still got some work to do on that. But it's not just that. It's not about me as an individual. It's about the strength that we have as part of a union, in my case, you know, as an organisation of workers collectively, and the NCEU, as much as it has its failings, is a union that has a lot of members that can be activated, and it has strength because of its collective strength. And when we're activists who are unified together with collective strength and a commitment to solidarity, and actually a commitment to not falling into passivity or falling into victimhood, that stuff matters to be strong enough, to be organized enough, to be able to do something right now, even when there aren't all of those surging struggles going on around us. So today, homophobia and transphobia are obviously still very real in people's lives and very damaging, but I think it's more important than ever that people get active and actually think through the strategies that are needed to win the battles ahead, because there are going to be many more. And having this discussion today and being here and being involved in socialist politics and finding out more about the club on campus and all that, I think is a really good starting point. So I encourage people to do that. And I'll hand over to Liz.